could all please take your seats. My name is Michael Hunter Schwartz, and I'm the Dean of the McGeorge School of Law, which is part of the University of Pacific, and we are absolutely thrilled to have you here for the 5th Annual Malone Lecture. With your kind permission, I'll try to minimize my embarrassment of our very generous sponsor, Mike Malone. I happen to just adore the guy. Mike graduated in the year I believe to be the perfect year to graduate from law school, 1987. Some weird coincidence for me. And he's a graduate of both McGeorge and an undergraduate Berkeley degree, which I also have a certain affinity for. So he's a double winner as far as I'm concerned. He's the president of California Advocates with over 38 years of experience representing a variety of clients before the legislature and state regulators. Before that, he worked as a legislative advocate for the California Society of Certified Public Accountants and the California Association of Realtors. Having now been in Sacramento for about 6 months, one of the things that I've discovered is that you have to work incredibly hard to find any kind of event anywhere in Sacramento, and certainly if there's a lawyer involved, and not see Mike there. I sort of come to believe that if an event happens and Mike is not there, it's sort of like a tree falling in a forest that no one hears. It's been a real pleasure for me to have multiple opportunities to get to know Mike. And it is with extreme gratitude that I welcome you to our 5th Malone Lecture. Thank you so much for being here.
Okay, thank you so much, Dean Schwartz. Can everyone hear me? We're kind of...
No.
Really?
Okay.
Usually I'm so good at being heard. Okay, well, are you going to bring it up and I can still sit? Maybe? All right. We're trying to make it louder. How about if I lean forward now?
Yes.
Now it's good. Okay.
Well, we'll just all lean.
Or we just talk really loudly.
We're going to try one or the other. Okay, I'm Mary Beth Moylan. I'm the Associate Dean for Experiential Learning at McGeorge. I'm very pleased to be the moderator of this discussion tonight. I think it's going to be lively. I first want to thank again our dean for his introduction of Mike Belote and also for his support of the Capital Center. This is a wonderful McGeorge program that we have at the law school. Our director of the Capital Center is Leslie Jacobs, and I want to thank her too. She's done an outstanding job making sure that we have really innovative, interesting programs, that our students have great curriculum, and that we're putting out young lawyers and other professionals into the community who have a focus on the Capitol. So Leslie, where is she? She's right there. Thank you so much, Leslie Jacobs. John Wainwright, who is our Capital Projects, our Capital Center Project Manager. He is behind our Cap Impact blog, and he also has really done everything to put this event together with the assistance of our excellent events team, Cassandra Fernandez and Stevie, now Sparks. So thank you guys so much. Let's just get right into our discussion. I'm going to just tell you who my panelists here are. I want to give you a very brief idea of what the structure of the evening looks like so you are not surprised.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. I'm going to ask them some questions. They're going to answer the questions. Time permitting, they are going to have an opportunity to ask each other follow-up questions. I call this the hand-to-hand combat phase. Then you get to engage in the questioning of our panelists. When that happens, I just want to be really upfront about this. I'm going to pick up one of these microphones, and I am going to walk around with it. I will hold the microphone. You will not hold the microphone. I have very strong arms, deceivingly so. But I will make my way through the crowd and allow you to ask questions. We are also doing Facebook Live time streaming something like that. Facebook Live. Thank you very much. So if there are people who are watching who have questions, they can type them in, and John Wainwright will be the questioner for those live stream questions. Okay, without further ado, we have tonight, can you still hear me or do I have to keep leaving? This is hard. Okay. We have tonight, to my immediate left, we have Jonathan Wiseman. He is the deputy editor for the Washington Bureau of the New York Times. We are very grateful that he flew out here this morning, and he's had an amazing career. He's written a book, you read about it, that's why you're here, so you can read more about it. Next to Jonathan, we have Joe Matthews. Joe is a California columnist. He's an editor for Zocalo Public Square. I also found out he does a million other things. He's just involved in so many different projects, I can't imagine. He also wrote a book. Again, look him up. He's got a lot of cool stuff. Finally.
The guy who didn't write a book.
John Myers. But even though John Myers did not write a book, he has been the moderator for gubernatorial debates in California. He is also the bureau chief of the Los Angeles Times, the Sacramento bureau chief for the Los Angeles Times. So we are so grateful to have such an interesting, accomplished panel, and I am going to stop talking now so they can start talking, bringing me to our first question. Okay, there is some debate about this, as it turns out. I was going to start by saying journalism as a profession has taken a bit of a popularity hit. They're not as in the doghouse as lawyers, but they're getting there. Some would say that that's a result of fake news. I would first like each of you to define fake news. What are we talking about when we say fake news? And then, if you agree or disagree with my sentiment about journalism's popularity, you can give your opinion on that. Okay?
Should I start?
You're up, John.
Okay. First of all, I want to say that my definition of fake news is completely different from yours, because fake news was an actual phenomenon. Fake news was not bias. Fake news was not news that we did not like. Fake news was a term that was created by to identify deceivers who would create false accounts that were supposed to look like real stories. The New York Times did a great story. Scott Shane, one of our fantastic investigative reporters, did a story about this guy, and he had just graduated from college, and he decided he was broke, he needed something, so he started writing false news stories on Facebook that he would post, and he was trying to figure out which would make him the most money, and he found that the stories that made him the most money, that got more clicks, got more ads, were just fake stories about Hillary Clinton, anti-Hillary Clinton stories. And in like 2 weeks, he made $20,000 by writing fake news. That's what fake news is. What Donald Trump says fake news is, that's not fake news. That's news he doesn't like. Or you could say it's biased news. I'm not gonna argue about what is or is not actually news without bias. But fake news is something else. Fake news is actually the intentional implantation of news to deceive, and that I will stick to that definition.
No, you.
Okay. I agree with that. I agree with that definition of fake news. I think the fake is easy. It's as you defined it. I find the news part of the thing harder, because what is news and is not fake. It's real. It's not. It's about something that's true. I think the bigger problem than this sort of deceit, as Jonathan Wild defined it, is our notions of news.
are sort of fundamentally misleading of what reality is. News is something that's, you know, that's it's the first time it's happened, or we think it's the first time it's happened because we don't have very long memories in this country. Or it's something that's extreme. It's radically different. And we have a lot of news. We're surrounded. It's inescapable. And so we're defining reality by extremes, not by sort of the middle movements in the movement, in the middle and average. So at some level, all news is kind of fake. It's sort of profoundly misleading, and you see it in how both ill-informed and misinformed. I mean, one of the things I find scary when looking at media studies is we're starting to see that people who, it used to be you should follow the news closely, it's part of being a good citizen, but now people who follow the news are actually more are more poorly informed. They're highly misinformed, and they actually have they're less likely to have an idea of what reality is than people who follow it, you know, occasionally and more moderately. I mean, news in this era has become sort of, it's, you know, you want to have that one glass of wine that the studies say that will, you know, keep your heart healthy, but you don't want to consume it in a heavy way. But unfortunately, our media organizations are dependent on us being heavy consumers, spending a lot of time, because that's what brings them revenue. So just to sort of expand the question, complicated. That's my answer.
I don't have any new definitions beyond that. I'm just going to take this off of there. We're just going to hang this around here, Joe. Okay, you and me, we're microphone buddies because I couldn't lean down that far. I agree with my colleagues here. I can't add to that. I would tell you I think that with some exceptions, and I understand there are exceptions to the definition I'm going to present. I think fake news is that piece of information that somebody says, can you believe this? It very likely is not believable anymore. I have routinely had family members who said, I saw on Facebook this thing you were not gonna believe. I'm like, right, because you're not gonna believe me either because I'm gonna tell you it's junk. And I think that used to be the standard we liked in the news business of attracting attention. Like, you know, this thing that you had, holy mackerel, wait till you hear this. But wait till you hear this, unfortunately, has become the standard for the stuff that it doesn't pass the smell test. I was just, the only thing I was going to say is, I know that fake news is the stuff that people shouldn't believe. That might be a traditional definition. I think fake news is the stuff that people want to believe often. I think it would not circulate so wide and so far if there wasn't a group of people who want it to be true and continue to bring it forward. I think it would die its own death if it was not circulated that way. So I would submit that it's a portion of information that people wish was real. And unfortunately, it doesn't turn out to be for them. And really for us, who have to then tell you that it's not real.
You know, we didn't talk about how unpopular we were. I will broach that subject because I actually feel we're really popular. I know that that's like the public opinion polls say that that's not true, and I'll just say that's fake news. No, but I feel like right now we are in something of what is left of newspaper reporters, at least, are kind of in a golden era. I mean, the New York Times and the Washington Post are in the kind of newspaper war that we used to dream about. And there is a new energy to investigative reporting, into accountability reporting, that I haven't felt in for most of my career. And I feel like people are recognizing it. And I think that people are appreciating the fourth estate like I've never seen before. But I'm a Washington journalist, and that's a really different thing than a lot of reporters working in mid-sized daily newspapers that are really struggling right now. So my perception of our popularity or unpopularity is very warped.
I think Jonathan has sort of got it right from his perspective. Someone spends a lot of time in odd corners of California and occasionally odd corners of the world. And journalists are deeply unpopular, not just in this country, but across the world. I think in many respects, we deserve to be. It's not an irrational. There are many reasons for it that are political, that are based on nonsense, but there are good reasons. We are, as you know, and it's not entirely our fault. You know, the business has changed in ways that mean that journalists are out amongst the people less in many cases. They're doing things faster in ways that makes it sort of natural to commit more errors. And, you know, we, you know, I mean, I think an incredible institution like New York Times, the Washington Post, I mean, the LA Times, where I used to work for 8 years and had a mother who worked for 25 years. You know, those are one picture, but you know, journalists really aren't there for communities. They're not tied to communities. They are, and we don't have many publication journalists who are kind of binding together and narrating the story of communities. I think it's even hard in, you know, significant cities like this one, where you have a wonderful newspaper. It's particularly wonderful on Sundays when they print my column. But there's not enough there to sort of, not enough people, and as we go online and our audience is decoupled from community, our audience is, you know, a lot of the audience from Sacramento Bee is not anywhere near Sacramento. A lot of the audience from the LA Times, New York Times, you know, New York Times is a national, international location, but not anywhere near LA. We've separated from community. We've done it for some reasons of survival, or because of technological change that came at us and we didn't get ahead of. But I think we deserve to be unpopular.
Yeah, but I know you're going to ask more about fake news, but let me just push back slightly on my friend Mr. Mathis coming. One of the challenges of being in journalism at this particular point it is the binding nature of journalism traditionally is hard when the communities aren't bound, when the people aren't bound. When they communicate with each other through devices and not actual interaction. And so there are 10 million places that people seem to get the information that makes their world tick now. And I think this gets to kind of what you were talking about the difficulty of it. But how many, I mean, this is just really briefly, very, very short. I do this sometimes when I talk to students. They're, no offense, they're a slightly younger group. This, you're all very adult and professional. That's not a jab, don't worry, the cocktails are coming. But how many of you, just a random show of hands, when you get up in the morning, before you look at any other place for information, grab one of these. I mean, not necessarily an iPhone, but a mobile device. That is a fundamentally different perspective than I think most of us grew up with. It's not the paper on the doorstep. It's not the 6 o'clock news. It's not the Today Show or Good Morning America or whatever it was always the Today Show in my family, but you know. But that's a fundamentally different way to get the information, and the information therefore hasn't been organized and you know, maybe negatively sometimes distilled for you. It is whatever you want, wherever you want it, however you want to get it. And I think that fundamental challenge to what we do, and I'll get back to the original topic here, is what opens the door for everything else. It has opened the door for so many other places for you to have a view of the world or your own life that has nothing to do with what we are trying to historically help you process.
So short of, should we do this too?
I don't know. It felt right on my side.
I think it works better for me.
Yeah.
So short of taking away all of the small devices, how do journalists transform then what you're doing to ensure that you're upholding journalistic standards, that you're weeding out unethical journalists, or that you're trying to get people the information they need? What are your solutions?
Well, you know, one thing is, We know so much about how our readers get their news. And we have this down to a science. We know that about 70% of a given newspaper story's article readers, a New York Times, at least a New York Times article's readers, will come from the phone. 70%. And of those 70%, about 30% will have come to it through Facebook and a smaller amount through Twitter. So, you We had all these grand plans of designing, you know, our homepage on nytimes.com, and then when tablets came out, when the iPad came out, we said, oh my God, we got to design a beautiful new New York Times app for this thing. Everybody's gonna be getting their news on this tablet. They're gonna be commuting to work and they're gonna be reading this tablet. Nobody reads their tablets. I mean, it's a tiny amount. I mean, nobody anticipated that everybody, like 70% of our readers would be reading their phone. We can't lament that. We just didn't deliver the news that way. And I don't necessarily think it's a bad thing. We would love to get people to come to the paper at least through the NY Times app on their phone. But if they're not gonna do that, we just have to adjust. It used to be that all of our newspapers used to make all their money from ads. Maybe like 70% of their money would come through ads, and 20% would come through subscriptions. Actually, it was probably like 10% through subscriptions, and then another 20% would get through want ads, classifieds. Classifieds then disappeared because of Craigslist. That was that gone. And then when people started getting their news through alternative channels like Facebook or Twitter, then our ad revenues just tanked. Because if you can't design like a website with banner ads across the top or things like that, you can't sell the ad, you can't go to your advertisers. So now almost all of the New York Times money comes from subscribers, which is a pitch. Everyone subscribed to something. I mean, I'm not saying the New York Times subscribed to something, because we are dependent now on our readers. But that also means that instead of shaping news to our advertisers, which we have been accused of for so many years, the advertisers are not even there very important anymore. We have to shape our news to readers. Now, Joe will tell you why that's so bad. Joe, take it away.
I mean, I think the issue is more fundamental. You asked about ethics and standards. And I actually think the profession's ethics and standards are a huge problem and need to be completely rethought and redone. I'm married to a journalist, to a Wall Street Journal reporter. I'm a child of two journalists, a man who's been at the Washington Post since the day he came home from Vietnam in 1971. Mother who had a long career in newspapers and television, retired from USA Today. I worked at the LA Times for many years and the Wall Street Journal. We also, all in the family, if you notice which big newspaper is missing that, we all hate the New York Times. But, you know, I like the traditional journalist ethics that we're sort of at a remote. We're a little bit priest-like, you know, we're supposed to be independent and separate. But the problem is no one ever really bought that ethic. The audience would believe that ethic. And it turned out when technological change came for us, when the economy came for us, our business had very few allies. And it's had a bloodbath. I mean, we've had a bloodbath in the century of losing journalists and people. So that ethics, whatever you thought of it, I liked it, was comfortable with it. I would have been happy enough to vote, you know, like Don Graham of the Washington Post famously never did. But I think we need an ethic that is the opposite, which is we should be as journalists as conflicted as possible. We should be as connected to as many different parts of the community as we can. So many that everyone is invested in this, and we're sort of fair. We're not playing favorites. We're deeply connected. That is a different vision of not just the job, but of living than most journalists, that go, certainly the ones in my family, lived under. But I think we need that connection. I've worked at these big newspapers. I work for a small nonprofit that gets to experiment. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to connect with as many kinds of institutions. We think academic institutions, museums, cultural institutions, things that have a mission where truth is part of it are natural allies. We'd like to expand it beyond that. We also like institutions that last a long time because we want to last a long time. And you know, I mean, if I could get the Catholic Church as a partner, I'd love that. But that's ethics. But then there's the standard issue, where our standards are not really that high. I mean, let's be honest. For truth accuracy, I mean, it's a place, it's fast, 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 and then correct.
Well, what standard do you want?
I want a higher standard. I want closer to an academic standard.
Give me the definition.
An academic standard. I mean, when you publish in an academic journal, you're going to have peer reviews. You're going to send the story to people, your article to people, and have people look at
it. So if I have an exclusive piece of information, do you want me to have it peer reviewed for a week before I run?
I'm not completely kidding. I'm actually curious.
So, I mean, really, what do you...
I would think there might be ways to do something like that.
Hold on.
They'll probably be a microphone model.
Hold on. I used to do television, so let me give you the tease for the 11 o'clock news. A scandal at City Hall tonight, we'll tell you next week.
I don't think that slowing down would be such a bad thing for the standards and quality of this profession.
You never give an ex-TV reporter a microphone, by the way.
One thing that I've done for all my career that might get me fired in certain places, I've always told my boss I was going to do it, is I show stories, pre-publication, to some of the sources in it, to people I trust who know the subject better than I. I mean, one of the things I feel so frustrated is so much journalism is produced by people who, because they have to have journalists get the right story, even though they know nothing about the place, the subject matter. I mean, I would rather actually sometimes the expert write it and I, the journalist, check them and edit them. I mean, that's part of our little model at Zocalo. But I think that kind of checking and showing things is deeply responsible. It's the kind of thing we should be doing more of. But again, it's some places you get fired for doing that. Isn't that a violation of journalists that they accept the New York Times?
If a New York Times reporter sent a full newspaper story pre-published to a source, he could get fired. That's absolutely true.
Yeah, and I honestly do that sort of thing all the time.
But let me borrow the microphone. You make a very good point, and I did the smart ass thing with the scandal next week, because that's what I like to do. Because I'm a parent, I do it to my kids. But I do think you make a good point, and maybe what we should strive for are models that fit the news we're doing, models that fit the time and the moment. And here's what I mean by that. The one thing that I have spent 17 years covering the state capitol, and one thing that I value from talking about public policy and government and politics is context. And so I think if we had more time for context and explanation in certain stories, which kind of gets to your peer review model, though I probably wouldn't show the story to someone either. I haven't looked in the ethics file of Trump, but I'm pretty sure I can't do that. But if we had more time for those stories and we had a way to suss them out and work on them, I agree with you. But then we need a model that needs to be flexible and fast for things that matter to the community. And one of the things that I was not a newspaper guy. As I said, I was a broadcast guy for 20 years. One of the things that I have been amazed by is the connection that our readers have had to the wildfires and to the mudslides, and where they come looking for information is us. They don't go to those other websites, they come to us. And we sometimes put the paywall down in this egalitarian moment that probably sucks for our bottom line. But if we could have models that could deal with crises in the community and information and what you need to know, and we have a model for reporting that out, and we have a model that gets to explanatory, contextual, thoughtful journalism, if we could drive our staffs and our editors to think in different ways to approach the content and not a one-size-fits-all model of presentation, delivery, editing, maybe that gets to where you're talking about. But I mean, obviously we can't do that in some stories. We can't do that in the wildfires and an evacuation, but we should do it before we explain something really complex that we need to make sure we know what the hell we're talking about, energy policy, climate, something.
I want to ask Joe. Okay, I'm going to give you a case study. Okay, so this is just last night. I'm not going to say anything that hasn't already been made public, but I'll give you a little peek at how news actually is made. So I edit much of the political stories in the Times, and one of our top political reporters, Jonathan Martin, came to me yesterday and was very hot and bothered. He was very excited because he got word that Eric Greitens, the governor of Missouri, a lawyer had called Jonathan Martin and had said, "Oh my God, we have this tape of this bizarre tape in which Eric Greitens' mistress was confronted by her husband about the affair that she was having with the now governor of Missouri. And in the tape, the husband is trying to drag this story out, and the mistress tells this really lurid story about how this guy, Eric Greitens, took all her clothes off, blindfolded her, tied her up with tape, and then took a picture of her. And she said, "What are you doing?" And he said, "If you say, tell anybody anything about what we are doing here, I'm going to publish these pictures everywhere." He made this threat. We had this from this tape from the husband and the wife. Then we also had a tape of the governor's counsel, the governor's lawyer from the state of Missouri, calling the husband's lawyer and asking him, "What do you got? What do you know? What do you know?" So we had them fishing for information. And we had a state senator, a Democratic state senator, Greitens is a Republican, corroborating this story that she had, that the governor had threatened to basically revenge porn his mistress. And we knew this was coming, and we were waiting to see if Jonathan Martin really wanted the New York Times to break this story. It's gonna be a huge story. Only in the Trump era is this not a huge story. but it would have been, like, 5 years ago would have been a huge story. But anyway, so we this was all coming out very late, and we ultimately did not write this story because ultimately decided we needed more. I mean, I would have written it. I'm the bad guy here. I would have written it. We ran it up the food chain, and Dean Baquet, the executive editor, said, "No way, we're not going to write that story." Then it all came out. It came out on local St. Louis television, and the St. Louis Post-Dispatch read, "Jonathan Martin wanted to kill me because I didn't publish it because he got beat." And we still haven't published a lot of those details. Now, do you think we did the right thing or the wrong thing?
I mean, I don't know all the particulars, but
I didn't need all
but that, that, but that, but that, but that care is one of the reasons I pay the absolutely ludicrously high subscription rate for the New York Times. Is more than $1,000 a year.
Hey, just get Sunday only. It's
the passive subscribers gives me a lot for, you know, $200 a year. I mean, I like that care. I mean, I think there's a contextual change to this that makes the need for accuracy and getting things right and being careful hard. I think the internet actually argues for being more careful and for higher standard. Because you notice to be, if it was just on the paper, then whatever mistake you made that might have gotten the thing wrong, it was sort of in a clip file or it was in a library, or if it was something that was wrong and really made a person look bad, you know, it went away rather quickly. But now the all these things are there forever. I mean, I'm creating not just a story, I'm creating a sort of a reference, and I don't want to get it wrong. There's another aspect to it, which is that, you know, for lots of reasons, business reasons. I mean, I think a lot of our concerns about business and competition and, you know, waiting a week for the City Hall scandal. But ultimately, you know, this is a democracy. And for democracy to work, we need people to have some baseline level of comfort. But instead, most of us are reaching, including Zocalo Book Square, are reaching people through the largest sewer that the humankind has ever created, Facebook. Okay, and on Facebook, you know, there's a sort of assault
on... No offense to those watching on Facebook Live.
There's assault on people who appear by name in our stories. I mean, used to, as a young reporter in the day era print, want to always get the name, first name, last, now, and get as many names as possible stories. Now, I actually look for reasons to keep individuals' names out of stories. Because I don't want, I think about, I'm putting them into this sewer. And people will pile on them, find them, dox them, and what happens? There's this sort of level of protection of people. I want a civic kind of public square in a democracy that people feel comfortable going into. Instead, we're sort of feeding everything into the sewer, and I just, I, 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 I'm definitely aware of, you know, sort of, you know, we're part of that. We're feeding that.
You're an optimistic guy.
Right. And we're putting people, I mean, because that's where our readers are, as you pointed out on that phone. But we're also attached. We're part of, you know, our job is to get people to read and stay with things, to spend more time online, not looking at other humans, their children, their spouses, what have you. You know, we're pulling people into this world that, you know, we're learning more may not be good for our health, our thinking. You know, I mean, it just seems to me that, you know, people in our profession tend to think of we're fighting for survival. We're in this crisis of technology and business model. I think we're in a profoundly crisis that is ethical and moral, and maybe even a public health crisis that we're part of. And it really worries me that I'm usually an outlier in things, but I'm way too much of an outlier in this, given, you know, the massive evidence and trouble out there. And I wish there were more conversation within the profession about that.
Okay, Joe, John, I think we actually moved into hand-to-hand combat phase without knowing it, so that's the good news. We're careening quickly towards public questions in just a second. I have one more, though. Maybe, John, you can start with this one.
All right.
We have a room full of many different people in many different professions, but you do have a lot of lawyers, probably disproportionately lawyers and lawyers in training in this room.
Many that I worry I've interviewed and wronged, and now I'm in because I've seen faces, but go ahead.
Well, that can happen too, yeah. I know. But what can the legal profession do you think, with helping to enter this discussion, maybe that springboarding off of what Joe's saying, how can we protect better the privacy rights and also ensuring that people aren't getting misinformation? And I'm trying to tie it back to our fake news thing here. Are there ways that we should be thinking about instituting new laws or new public policies that would help with ensuring that journalists can do their jobs and provide truthful reporting to the public?
Well, you gave me the easy question, didn't you? I don't know, so let's go to everybody else. I mean, I think it's a very... It's a difficult issue for the obvious reason. It's a very delicate issue with protected speech and freedom and press and regulatory functions and so I don't know. I mean the things that always strike me about this are that the regulatory structure of the universe that we get information for has never really been fully examined. And I think that it needs a full examination. I think, you know, maybe to Joe's public health crisis, it is tantamount to something that needs to be a broader national discussion where people really approach it as a public health, as an imperative for society to talk about what's the regulatory framework, what's the accountability. I don't necessarily want to stop what people see, but I think there needs to be accountability for the source of what they saw. I think more transparency would be better. I mean, I think that's being a journalist. I'm a transparency fan. So I think anything that we could do to make it easier to see where the information is coming from. I mean, and I liken this because I'm a political reporter back to campaign money and records in the legislature. I can tell you that story lately. And all kinds of things. And the less transparency you have, the more people are unwilling to reveal the whole chain of events, the worse it gets. I think people think, well, you know, we leave all this stuff out there unfiltered and people don't know what to make of it. We'll make something, we'll figure it out. But that inability to know, I think, lets people hide behind a wall that that is not fair to the public to understand the information. So I would advocate for some way to boost accountability by transparency where the material is coming from.
I think we also need a sense of what is, and I think lawyers can help this, what is an actual media outlet versus a platform. For instance, Twitter has terms of service. I'm very aware of this because on Twitter it says that nobody can use it to post pornography. No one can use it to post anything that it disparages somebody by race, by sexual orientation, by religion. These terms of services are useless. Nobody polices them. Facebook has terms of service as well. If we can look at Facebook and say, look, Facebook is not a newspaper. It is not covered by the same rules as the First Amendment is different for a platform than a media outlet. And Facebook is a private company that is presenting information or access or connections. And if you're going to have terms of service, the terms of service need to be real. They need to be policed, they need to be enforced, and they need to have some teeth in them. And somehow there has to be some legal definition of what can be put onto these platforms that's different from the protections that are afforded to the New York Times, the LA Times, Zocalo, Public Square, which are news outlets.
I think of legal questions in two ways. I hate to praise Europe. I do a lot of work in a collaboration around democracy and respect for democracy. A lot of European journalists, and they're so holier than thou and annoying that I hate to agree with them about that. But some of the European privacy laws, the right to be forgotten, strike me as, they sort of, in my lizard brain, they feel un-American, but they may have there's some wisdom to them. If they give people enough protection that they're willing to participate in the public sphere, at Zocalo, I worked in big newsrooms, which were very white places in America, still are in 2018. I'm now in a place where, as a white male, I'm a minority in two ways. And one of the problems I think we have in this, in terms of having representation amongst journalists, but also in representation in the audience, and for people who show up in our stories, is that it's just a fact if you're a woman or if you're a minority, everyone pays a price to be in this sewer of a public sphere we've got, but I think the price paid by if you're a woman minority is indisputably much higher. You take more abuse, and we have to do something about that.
Okay, Joe, I'm going to cut you to enter. I want these folks to get in on it.
Sure.
Ready?
Can I just make one totally different point?
Our open
records and open meetings laws basically, certainly in this state, actually serve to deter the public and the press, and they become ways to keep people out of things, particularly in an era where governance is not really done by law or by right, but it's all by negotiation. Coming up with ways to get the public and the press in to see the negotiation and not just be at the hearing after the decision's really been already made, that there's a great legal opportunity for a legal mind smarter than mine there.
Okay, great. So hands up and I will come around. I saw you right away, sir. Nope, I'm holding.
I have an observation that will frame a question. And it relates to the coverage of the law, attorneys, and the courts. And the observation is this, at least in the print media on the local level, you no longer have experts in the law. The Denny Walshes of the Sacramento Bee are gone. And you have people that cover the courts that really don't understand the law. And also you don't get enough column space to really explain what happened. I have known of cases or been in the court and I walk out the next day, I read an article, and it's like I was in a different place. And then the other observation is this, when I see coverage, particularly United States Supreme Court, there is always a political spin on it. The reporters always have to say, all of the Republican appointees voted this way, and the Democrat appointees voted this way. I was on the court with people appointed by five different governors of different political philosophies, and never once did I see that politics ever got involved. It's maybe a jurisprudential philosophy. So my question is twofold. What doesn't the media, particularly the print media, or even any media, have an obligation to have experts to cover these stories and report them accurately? And two, why is there this emphasis that it undermines credibility of the courts to try to publicize everything? And why report that they're Republican appointees or Democrat appointees? that ruled in a particular favor. Why not just address the rule of law and the whole?
Let me do the expert one too, and I've been in Judge Gutman's courtroom before, in the appellate courts. I've seen you work. And I consider myself somewhat eager to understand things I don't know, but I'm not a lawyer, and I don't play one on television. I think that the fundamental challenge for having an expert in something as complex as the law is that we don't pay enough. I mean, I worked in television news, and when a starting salary for a television news reporter with debt out of college is in the high 30s, low 40s, that person, you know, I mean, so if you want someone with a law degree or a law background, we don't pay it. Now, I'm not saying, you know, and I'm giving you the extreme bottom of the end. Obviously, a more experienced reporter will make more, but the combination of pay and the aversion to specific beats for a long time in your career, reporters work their way up to get to a beat. They don't start on that beat, and when something's going down in a particular courtroom, odds are, and I'm speaking from my broadcast experience now more than my print experience, you have a reporter that comes in at 2 o'clock in the afternoon and there's a verdict in the trial at 4, and that person just walked in the door at 2, they have a thankless task. And I know that all of you have seen it from the other side, like, why the hell did they get it wrong? Let me defend that 28-year-old reporter who walked in the door at 2 o'clock in the newsroom. What is she going to do to prep herself in time to be on the news at 5? And this is a broadcast issue, I think I'm showing my old broadcast rights. It's very, very hard. And I don't have a great answer for it, but I do think it starts with money and expertise that the business doesn't seem to value enough. We should value it more, but we don't. The other parts I'll leave others to.
I mean, I think Elite Newspapers, his newspaper, has a Supreme Court and legal reporter who's a lawyer, Adam Liptak, right?
He was the New York Times corporate lawyer, and then went out. Adam Liptak was actually the Times. Was the Times' corporate lawyer, and then when Linda Greenhouse, our longtime Supreme Court reporter, decided to retire, Adam said, "Hey, I'd like to try this."
But
he's damn good at it.
But larger news organizations have that luxury.
You've had medical doctors who report on things in there. You have scientists who do science coverage. There have been efforts to try to do that. There's an interesting firm at the University of Toronto that tries to take people out of professional fields. They've actually had a lot of good luck with lawyers, because apparently lawyers all hate being lawyers. But other kinds of expertises, and have tried to place them. They've actually had an odd collaboration with the Dallas Morning News that has turned a fair number of experts into journalists in Dallas. It would be great to do more of that. I think you could. I think, you know, I mean, I live in a world of foundation funding and things, and I think you could probably fund more of that.
You did ask about length of stories too, by the way, and I think there's a whole universe of metrics and research about the length of a story. There's counterintuitive stuff that some very long stories are so compelling people will read the whole thing on their phone. But there is a big, interesting debate about that I didn't really realize, and I realized it in broadcast about the length of a story on TV. I didn't really realize it until I went to the Times, the 600-word, 800-word, 900-word story, please God don't make it 1,400 words. We're in this really weird period of people trying to find the sweet spot for the device that I just talked about, even though that should not be the metric by a good story, but it becomes the metric in the world that we're living in.
How about the labeling of the judges as Republicans?
I want to say something about that. In our world, we want to give more information, not less. And I will always, I think that everybody should know that. I'm sorry, I absolutely disagree with you on that. I think we should say, this is a Bush-appointed lawyer, this is a Reagan-appointed lawyer, this is an Obama-appointed lawyer. Absolutely. What is the harm to that?
The harm is it undermines public confidence in the courts because they think the decision's political when they're not political. There are bases on, some people will say that they are political. I'll tell you, they're not, in my view. They're a matter of who the person is, what jurisprudential philosophy they have, what life experience they have. It's not because they're an R or a D.
It seems, well, it does not seem coincidental that Republican, more recently, Republican-appointed Supreme Court justices and Democrat-appointed Supreme Court justices do tend to fall on two different sides of cases, not always. And in fact, when it's not always, it's really instructive that you have, you know, an 8-0 decision, or and if you like the decision on the governor of Virginia's case, corruption case, that was a unanimous decision. Because it was a unanimous decision, it was all the more important to know that these were Republican appointees and Democratic appointees. I just think that is. It is up to readers can decipher that. I don't think it's our job to decide. Well, we don't want to warp their pretty little minds by telling them
the Windsor Whites or the Harry Blackmans or the Souters are no longer there because the presidents are doing a better job in vetting the candidates to get the type of people with the jurisprudential philosophy they want. It's not a matter that they're Republican appointees or Democrats.
We should go on to another question. I will
thank
say.
Yeah.
I hope you're holding. I was a reporter for a long time. Now I run the news bureau for the university, so this is really interesting and fascinating for me. At my first newspaper, the Des Moines Register, we had very strict standards about quoting public officials. My question is, what is with the obsession, both broadcast and newspaper, with quoting the president on Twitter? And do you think that if you as journalists would stop repeating everything he spews on Twitter, that might reduce the power of why? I mean, back in the day,
right.
If I was going to quote the governor, I'd have to verify that quote with the press office saying, yes, he said this at such and such event. It doesn't seem to me that standard exists anymore because of Twitter.
It's a good point, and I think I see it differently. And I think my difference is, for decades, we have quoted a press release quote from someone. For decades. And I was a broadcast reporter who hated it because it didn't work for me. I didn't have anybody on camera or on tape. And my newspaper colleagues would use it. It was the ginned up quote that somebody would send me from State Senator Joe Smith. And it would say the following. And it wasn't, I mean, the verifiable level of that to me is the same as Twitter. I just kind of unfortunately think that if the President of the United States was off mic, like we were here, and said what he said today, or, well, that actually wasn't Twitter, but whatever he said, you know, someone would say, well, he wasn't really talking to a reporter there, he wasn't really, you know, are you sure that was his voice? I mean, there were a lot of voices in there. We would endeavor to report that, and I think he has to stand accountable for the Twitter feed. I think, come hell or high water, the Twitter feed is his. The better question for me is, why doesn't he turn the Twitter feed off? And he won't turn it off because it's his only chance to be who he wants to be, for whatever reason he wants to be that guy. And I could not in good conscience not report what is supposedly attributable to the President of the United States. Whatever he says, it's his. He's got to own it.
I would defend, and I'm not a defender of the journalistic profession, I consider myself a charter member of journalists who hate journalists.
Self-loathing.
Yes, exactly. Definitely a self-hating journalist. But I would say, I in Oakville we publish mostly non-journalists. We publish lots of scholars, and then all kinds of people from expert life arc theory is people who know the subject best. We publish on every possible subject from places all over the world, art, science, and the like. And I have to say, for the last year, as an editor and a signer of stories, my biggest headache and the thing I spend the most time doing is taking gratuitous mentions of Trump out of stories. You tell people when you assign a story, and these are regular people, these are not journalists writing, everyone wants to stick Trump references into stories. It is an epidemic. He has a mind share that is, it's unreal. In stories that have nothing to do with Trump. It's unbelievable when it happens. And a story about Saudi Arabian art I was editing recently that I had to take over a Trump reference app.
I want to know what it was, but I guess it's
I've got two more questions, and then we'll see if we have time for a third. So we'll try to keep answers.
Just get a cocktail and sit back down.
This may be a little off topic, but can you discuss the evidence associated with state campaigns of fake news and their impact on American institutions.
I already mentioned earlier, Scott Shane is one of our investigative reporters who's really burrowed in on fake news on Facebook. And he was talking about, just the other day, we were doing a panel, and he was talking about the sheer number of people who saw either Facebook ads or Facebook articles that were put in by the Russians. And it is staggering. It was 125 million people were, I think, I can't remember the great word that Facebook used, I think were serviced by the Russians. Basically half the adult population of the United States had seen Russian content that was put into Facebook. And if you think about that President Trump won the presidency, his losing margin was the largest losing margin of a winning president since 1876, and his winning margin in three states, Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania, was about the number of people who fit into Lambeau Field every Sunday. You can't say for sure that the Russians won the election for him, but you can't say they didn't. You simply cannot, because the just staggering amount of material that actually got placed before people, and you're still seeing it right now. The Russians are trying to throw the election in Estonia, and you know, we don't know exactly what they're going to do in 2018, but we know that very little has been done to stop them. I'm not sure what the Russians would want to do. We don't know if they would, if disruption is what they want. Do they want Democrats to win this time? Or do they want, I don't know, we don't know. But we do know that they are relentless, and they're still very much out there, because the federal government has done very, very little to try to reverse the tide.
As Scully answered your question, is a lot of the research on this is new, but that what early research suggests that we're actually pretty good at discerning fake news and not being too affected by it. We're much more affected by news that is not fake, that is real or truthful, but highlights things that are out of the ordinary, extreme, and thus give us an incorrect misinformation about what is really true. And that I think is the real news is more dangerous than the fake news, at least as far as we know.
I'm going to leave that there. That's so optimistic. Let another one get in.
Hi, thank you for being here. My name's Catherine. You guys all seem very altruistic in your motives behind news, which is counterintuitive for me in regards to fake news. So I was wondering if you could speak to sort of public expectation concerning journalists and trust with the public between the news that's put out, especially amongst polarity in news sources, and sort of how to differentiate between those and just the environment with all of those issues.
Everybody's looking at me. Go ahead. Give it a shot.
I mean, look, it's funny. Altruism is not, I do not think is what drives reporters that I know of. I mean, I think reporters are driven by competition. The decline of mid-sized daily newspapers has been very damaging in that sense. Because I once knew a McKinsey consultant who said that what we should do with news is we should have like one reporter sitting in the White House briefing room, and that person writes down what the White House said that day, and then somebody goes and hangs out, and one person goes to the press conferences in Congress, and that person writes down, and then the newspapers and broadcasts basically just compete on packaging. And I said, you have no idea what drives news. What drives news is the desire to be first, the desire to break news, the desire to get your name out there. That instinct is really, really powerful. And so I would not call that altruism. I would actually call it arrogance. But it's the competitive urges of newspaper reporters and obviously broadcast reporters is intense, and that drives a lot of the coverage. I mean, when the Washington Post and the New York Times, for a time, it was like at 5 o'clock every day, somebody was going to pop a Russia story, and you felt like prize fighters. Who was going to knock them out? And every day we were waiting for what they were going to put out, and every day they were waiting for us, and we wanted to win that day, and we were digging and digging and digging, and that was what was driving us. So polarity is obviously, you know, this is an issue that we at the New York Times wrestle with, because 30% of this country believe that anything that's in the New York Times is fake. We are not trying to create fake news, and we are also not trying to polarize our news. But I'm sure that if I was sitting next to a Fox reporter, he or she would say the same thing. Yes, 30% of the country thinks that what that person is putting out is fake. But that person would probably say he too is not trying to create polarized news. That's just, I don't know. I'll let Joe finish that sentence.
Yeah, I'm not sure altruism or even, I've never wanted to be I'm never a big breaking news person. I actually don't want to be a name out there. I find this era of journalism where you're supposed to be a little more personal, very weird. You're put more of your person in the stories. I feel like it's actually changed my personality to try to operate as a columnist. I'm actually not that interesting, but.
You're incredibly
interesting. No, but I have to kind of be more interesting. It's kind of a weird.
You have to seem more interesting.
Yeah, you have to seem more interesting.
Fake news.
That's why things are actually kind of interesting. Right. And sometimes things happen and I can write about it. The reason I do this is partly nosy. It's such a great passport to have this job, to go places you wouldn't otherwise go, to ask people and learn. I'd love to learn. I've chosen to not do the national thing, but because I'm from California, this long family history in California, I just have this love for it, this affection that comes around in this giant California family, because no one in our family ever knew what birth control was for like four generations. And so it's just, I have all the Jehovah's Witnesses in Modesto are my relatives, basically. And there's something about being part of this place and how it connects to, history of my family, that there's no place like on earth like it. It's partly a love. I just love this place. What it means, its history, its present, and people. And I think to do this, there has to be a love of something, and that, for me, it's really a love of this place.
Let me see if I can be short here, because I don't have the, have that large family, apparently. I got into journalism 24 years ago, and I think I was very idealistic, and I used to tell people, I think it's a public service. I want to do it because I think it's a public service. And then I got way the hell away from that, and it becomes competitive, and it becomes lots of other things. And now, as I'm approaching the other end of the career, I go back to the public service moment for a moment, because I think there's value in explaining the world to people. The thing I was struck with really quickly, little blurbs here, because I know I'm going to get cut off, but Jonathan's point, what's that?
You're not going
to
get cut off.
But to Jonathan's point, we are super competitive, but I do lament that we can't find where to cooperate and where to be competitive. Even the Post and the Times have somewhat cooperated and competed back and forth with the Trump administration news out of there. We do collaborate sometimes. It's called the Associated Press. We run the AP Wire sometimes. When the AP Wire goes up on something that I don't want to write out of our bureau, I'm like, thank God for the AP. Because then we don't all have to go replicate that story, and we can go spend some other time. So I do wish, as we look for these models in this new era of journalism, we could find ways to collaborate and compete at different times, if we could work on that a little bit. But the other part I would say is, I know that one of the kind of the subtexts of this whole evening about fake news is that this is such a particularly polarized, tense, unsettled time, and I think a lot of journalists feel it. I think you've seen content in our newspapers and on broadcast that you've never seen before. I think you've seen
a particularly sharp poke back, push back at a leader who I think has pushed and prodded in ways that others haven't. But it's unsettling. It's really unsettling for a lot of people. I was unsettled, just to be personal for a moment, when I saw that a subsidiary of Walmart was selling online a t-shirt that had a tree and a noose, and it said, "Tree rope journalist, some assembly required."
Oh.
And I'm like, great. You know, I've got an 8-year-old and a 10-year-old will be 10 tomorrow. And that's an unsettling moment for me as a parent, as a professional, that someone would see it that way. I still think it's a public service. I still think there is context and explanation we can offer. I know we can do better. I know, and this is the great thing about being in a room of lawyers. All lawyers don't speak for each one of you in here, right? Right. All journalists don't speak for me. And all journalists don't speak for every news organization. We need to do better about the people in our profession. They don't do a good job. But I don't throw that out. I don't throw that baby out, so to speak. I think that there is still value in what we're doing. We've got to find a way to connect. We have to find a way to tell those stories. I think a lot of it is a public service. So maybe I'm older and now naive yet again in some way. So.
Well, I think that's a really excellent summary. I think is a good way. When we're not ending, we're just moving to the next phase, which is the reception. And so I want to take one moment before we move to the more personal conversations that we can have with our guests to thank you all so much for being here. This was a really interesting
Thank you
so much.
I know.